Hello. I mentioned Sogo Ishii, who apparently has somewhat recently changed his name to Gaku Ryu Ishii. But anyway, I sort of grew up knowing him as Sogo Ishii, so I suppose I'm just gonna have to call him Mr. Ishii. It's just Ishii in this video because I cannot for the life of me come to say Gakuryu Ishii here. But anyway, artist formerly known as Sogo Ishii. I love Prince, so I'm right at home saying something like that. But anyway, yes, the artist formerly known as Sogo Ishii. I mentioned him in that video that I did of, was it Shohei Imamura? I don't know. I did some other video about my personal view on the work of some artists and I mean some art house directors and Sogo Ishii's name came up. I said that I wouldn't do this because I just haven't seen all of the films by Ishii, and yeah, I haven't seen, like, I've seen half of those maybe. Some of those are just really obscure. I mean, I said that I wouldn't like doing it because the whole point of doing this is if I would have seen films that others wouldn't have seen. And so it's kind of embarrassing doing this with, you know, having gone only halfway the intended distance, but I suppose I'm so at a loss as to what should be the next episode in this, so that I might as well do it on Ishii. But but yeah, it definitely pisses me off that I haven't been able to see Crazy Thunder Road or Burst City, because talking about Ishii without having seen those two films is like talking about Fellini and not having seen La Strada or La Dolce Vita. It just feels like this feels like having focused on the wrong things. But so this, it's I actually the last time I was at the local DVD store, I actually saw a DVD of Ishii's Isn't Anyone Alive, which he did in 2012. But because it wasn't advertised as a Sogo Ishii movie, I mean, I would have recognized the name Sogo Ishii. I would recognize the name from having read some Midnight Eye essays about Japanese sort of more obscure Japanese filmmakers. You know, I would have recognized the name Sogo Ishii, but it's probably good that I didn't, because I might have been foolish enough to buy that Isn't Anyone Alive, and it was a fairly horrendous movie, I thought. So it's gonna I meant something else. Oh yeah, what I went with was actually Jacques Rivette's Céline and Julie Go Boating, which I have seen, but not in like a decade, so it's something I need to rewatch. The reason I mention it is because I realized that there was something like half of an Alain, sorry, half of a Jacques Rivette retrospective at the Cinémathèque going on right now, and like it's not a full series of his movies, but just a couple of them, and they're showing Out One, the 13-hour cut of Out One, in like four parts or something, and I missed it. They showed it like 2 weeks ago or something, and I missed it. I mean, they only have really, they only have the kind of more boring Rivette films there anymore, which I've already seen and definitely don't want to rewatch. But yeah, this is the price to pay when you think you can just dismiss the programming as probably just too boring to bother with, and then out of nowhere they have something like Rivette's Out One. Not the Nolimme Tangere, but the 13-hour Out One. Well, yeah, I still wouldn't be in shape of doing an entire like an entire overview on Rivette, and I probably wouldn't do it because I just fear that Rivette fans wouldn't necessarily you know. I mean, with some of the French Nouvelle directors, I mean, with some of them, I feel that I'm not entirely, you know, fair in my opinions. I would have seen enough Godard films to enough Godard films to do a video about him, but again, it's you know, if I think of something like Godard's L'Histoire du Cinéma as a fairly bad project, it's me not necessarily being on the wavelength of the people who might be potential viewers. So I'll try to do these things and directors where I'm sort of more or less sharing an aesthetic sensibility with the director. I suppose I shouldn't do this kind of rambling unnecessary introduction, which has nothing to do with Sogo Ishii, but I feel so disheartened by not having seen Crazy Thunder Road and Burst City that it's just it doesn't make me feel very good about doing this with with such glaring omissions. But I suppose I sort of talked myself into doing this. So anyway, let's indeed jump to those Sogo, sorry. To those films of Ishii that I have seen. Okay, so I think those I'm looking at the filmography of his on the left of my screen. Those first projects that the is showing, I think at least for the first film, he made it whilst he was still in film school. Yeah, I mean, Out of his 70s film, 70s films, I've only seen one of the films that he's done before 1984, the year. I mean, he has certain dystopian projects, but not having to do with all before the time period of that. This is going great. How am I doing? Yeah, sorry about that. Sorry about that. So the artist formerly known as Sogo Ishii, I don't know why he changed his name. Like, I didn't read any interviews. But as you may or may not be able to infer, the artist formerly known as Sogo Ishii, he does have a certain randomness to him, so can I help it having a certain randomness here as well? Okay, let's start in full earnestness. So the first Sogo Ishii film that I've actually managed to see was his 1978 feature film called Panic in High School. I think this is Sogo Ishii remaking his first work, which is a short film called Panic in High School. I haven't seen the short film and I don't particularly want to see it. Because I was actually rather disappointed in the feature film Panic in High School. Actually, Ishii himself was also disappointed. I think what happened is that anyone who looks at the first half of Ishii's career is what's immediately obvious that he's like having a punk mentality to filmmaking. It's a bit if people have seen Shinya Tsukamoto's movies, for instance, he did that cyberpunk classic of the Iron Man, and Tsukamoto, I'd say that Tsukamoto is like the slight Tsukamoto seems like the slightly more famous equivalent of Ishii, in that I managed to see quite a bit of Tsukamoto movies like a decade ago when I was really caring about Japanese, tracking down some Japanese classics or counterculture classics, whatever you want to call them. But yeah, I mean, based on my slight familiarity with Ishii's early work, it definitely reminds me of Shinya Tsukamoto. But anyway, like, you see that Ishii clearly wants to be a punk filmmaker, but the problem with that Panic in High School film is that, it was made by something like a major studio. I mean, I think a major studio with slightly trashier tastes. I can't remember the name of the studio right now, but studio with slightly trashier tastes, and I think Ishii got into it thinking that he'd be allowed to make something like a punk movie, but then the studio hired another director to, as if be like some sort of an insurance policy that this wild rookie wouldn't Seiichi Suzuki was famously fired by his studio after he made Branded to Kill, because the studio boss saw that film and said that it was, he said something like, it was an incomprehensible piece of garbage that no human could understand. And, you know, ironically, that probably became Suzuki's biggest success, at least later on. But anyway, like, the studio was trying to prevent the studio was trying to prevent panic in high school from going by the way of Suzuki's Branded to Kill. So they tried to have, like, a stabilizing balance of a co-director to Ishii, and I think what happened in that is that Panic in High School, like, I read a couple of fairly positive reviews of that film recently, but I personally disliked it, and I know that Ishii himself also was, like, cutting ties with the project. And I think what's happening is that it's like a film that's sort of caught trying to sit between two chairs, so that it's like it's a film where some people other than Ishii are trying to sort of make it a bit more vanilla, so that it's like too bland to be an insane movie, but then sort of too unpleasant to be like some sort of a serious drama. So that regardless of what kind of like tonality you're wanting it to strike, I feel like I really wonder for whom this movie could possibly play big. I mean, you know, it has I mean, considering the subject matter, it almost has like some sort of, it's as if it goes, like, it's as if it's trying to be like a light, like doing some lighthearted whimsy, you know, with its funk soundtrack, and I don't know. I didn't particularly like Lindsay Anderson's If. I suppose if you compare If to Panic in High School, I'd say that Eve certainly comes out looking a lot better, but you know, well, I don't even feel like having that discussion. To me, it feels like you know, the studio getting cold feet. It's sort of a convenient excuse to dismiss that movie, because it became something that none of the parties involved entirely wanted. So that, it's just, Ishii's Panic in High School just to me felt like a movie that, you know, could very, very justifiably be forgotten. I don't exactly have anything positive to say about it. Now, it's a shame, because to me, it seems like when I look at the Ishii filmography, it seems like his sort of classic period is just three films long. And the only one of those which I've seen is the one that I disliked pretty intensely. I mean, it's just... yeah, I didn't care for that. And then I haven't been able to see Crazy Thunder or then Burst City. Like it's seriously either annoying or bewildering that a film like Isn't Anyone Alive is getting sort of wide enough a DVD distribution with like the only merit, the only thing that Isn't Anyone Alive has going for it is that it's a fairly recent movie. That's it. That's about the only thing that you can say about it. Like it deserves a release because it's semi-recent. But yeah, something like Panic in you know, Crazy Thunder and Burst City, which seem like Ishii's two biggest classics, and like the two most well, I don't know if I want to call them unique, but certainly Crazy Thunder and Burst City, they don't like you know, how should I put it? They aren't exactly the umpteenth remake of the 47 Ronin, you know? So, like, if you're bringing back some vintage efforts from Japanese cinema, I mean, you know, at least Crazy Thunder Road and Burst City would seem like they're doing something different. But unfortunately, I haven't been able to see them. You know, the clips that I got, or I think I saw a trailer of Burst City, and it sort of reminded me of a Fernando Arrabal movie called Car Cemetery. Now, you know, I actually really liked Car Cemetery by Arrabal. I mean, it doesn't really mean that much if I say that I thought that it was Arrabal's best movie, but it's just, you know, well, I mean, I liked Car Cemetery, and I wouldn't mind watching a couple of films that would be a bit like that, but you know, Car Cemetery wasn't exactly easy to get across, and this seemed like a sort of equally forgotten fare. But yeah, it seems like what I personally sort of associate with like when I first saw it, like years ago, when I first read about Sogo Ishii, the three films that sort of piqued my interest were those from 78 to 82, you know, Panic in High School, Crazy Thunder Road, and Burst City. But since I haven't been able to see those two latter efforts, we're just gonna have to skip over them, and I already said that, you know, it's sort of annoying me that those should be the whole point of this video, but we're just pretty quickly exiting it. You know, I think it's entirely possible that just like I thought that Panic in High School wasn't a very good movie, it's entirely possible that Crazy Thunder Road and Burst City aren't good movies. Like, I don't know since I haven't seen them, but I recognize the possibility that just because those would be his, like, sort of vintage period doesn't mean that those are his three best movies. I don't know. But I definitely dislike you know, having to settle to watch some poorly representative, you know, late period genre films. Like, I'll talk a bit more about those Ishii films that I have managed seeing. But yeah, my main interest was certainly towards Crazy Thunderbird and Burst City. Hopefully it's sometime in the future I can cross them off of my watch list. But anyway, the next film that I have actually managed seeing is his 1984 film called The Crazy Family. Now, it's so easy to it's so easy to say that some family that movie depicts is crazy, but I can't offhand think of another family that just so earns the title. The word crazy can be turned like just thrown around so casually that it's almost an understatement to just how batshit insane this movie was. I actually have a perfect description of that movie, but it's sort of necessitating a certain state of being cine literate by audiences to understand it. But if you know that Michael Haneke movie, The Seventh Continent, if you imagine the Japanese director Sion Sono remaking The Seventh Continent, I think you'd have the crazy family. Sion Sono is pretty out there. I mean, that's putting it mildly. Sion Sono isn't exactly like I'd be pretty comfortable putting Michael Haneke and Sion Sono at the absolute opposite sides of the filmmaking spectrum. Even if Haneke is sometimes pushing the boundaries and so on, he's doing it as a very serious dude. So, like, it's almost blowing my mind that someone could so naturally sort of combine two such opposite poles. The Crazy Family, it was I cannot offhand think of a crazier Japanese movie that I have seen. A couple of Takashi Miike efforts. A couple of Takashi Miike efforts could be contenders, but The Crazy Family is a pretty out there movie. If you saw that Roman Polanski film version of the stage play called God of Carnage, now if some audiences thought that that film had about as much carnage as like a My Little Pony episode, and those audiences felt cheated and that they'd feel like they'd want an actual that they'd want a movie that actually lives up to the title of God of Carnage. I think the melee involved in the Crazy Family more than earns the title God of Carnage. Like, this was just such an out there movie. It's like a Russian, that Matushka, that Russian doll where there's like dolls inside dolls. Like, this has such degrees of craziness. I didn't initially like the movie. I just thought that it was sort of annoying, wacky clowning. And I was like, God, I'm not in the mood for like 90 minutes of some there was that Wait, I think my baby brother has it on a DVD. There was this slightly obscure Studio Ghibli movie called My Neighbor the Yamadas. Now, when I first started, like when I was watching The Crazy Family, at first I thought that it was just gonna be like a really tame, like, wacky live action version of the kind of antics that the Yamadas are pulling in the movie, and I totally could not see just how far this movie was willing to go with its craziness. Like, whenever you think, like, you watch it, you like, you watch it, you think that the film is peaking with its craziness, and it just finds a way to turn it up to 11 again and again and again. And like, this film has some fucking massive gears of craziness that it's able to ascend to. Like, like, this is a film that definitely has the potential to be highly offensive. Like, yeah, I don't know whether audiences are able to enjoy it, but I mean, just on some level, the total lack of restraint shown by Ishii and company, like on some level, even the people who are highly offended by the movie have to admit that it's like just as far as the manic energy goes, it is a somewhat impressive achievement. Like, I was definitely surprised. Like, I mean, I honestly thought, like, I mean, yeah, I definitely didn't see this movie coming. I definitely didn't see this movie coming. I mean, like, I was just, I was almost going with the movie in spite of myself. Like, I don't know if I even wanted to like it, but I actually thought that it was a fairly, I thought that it was gonna be like a semi not interesting Yuzo Itami movie or something. And then when it was just like, putting Miike at his craziest to shame, yeah, I didn't see that movie coming. So The Crazy Family, I mean, I think, like, if I felt bad about not being able to see Crazy Thunder Road and Burst City, the out of nowhere, almost classic status that The Crazy Family was able to reach, it sort of made it up, I didn't feel so bad after watching this movie, although, like, this was like, David Lynch apparently described the Saragossa manuscript as one mother of a movie. Like, I think The Crazy Family is a film that you could describe in those terms. It was truly crazy. So if you can handle it, I highly recommend it. If there's the slightest doubt that you have about watching a completely batshit insane movie, then maybe you shouldn't. But then, Sogo Ishii, the artist formerly known as Sogo Ishii, probably isn't like the director for you. But yeah, The Crazy Family was certainly something like an event. Now, the film that he did after that, called Halbermensch, so like, is it half man or half human? I studied German in high school, but I was such a shitty student that My advancement was from slight to none. Anyway, Halbermensch. Yeah, it's Halbermensch. I saw it like over a decade ago. I couldn't be bothered to rewatch it. It was some sort of a performance video of some industrial rock band from Germany or something. I've already forgotten mostly what it is. I don't know. I mean, as I said, it's like the availability of fairly random minor works is almost like pouring salt on the wounds of not being able to see the major works. So, like, I don't even want to talk about those kinds of slightly more random moments that I have been able to see. The next feature film that I have been able to see is Angel Dust from 1994. And I thought that this was a completely worthless movie. It sort of reminded me of some of those slightly more basic Kyushi Kurosawa J-horror movies. Except I think that Kyushi Kurosawa is I think that he's basically from good to very good, sort of depending on the project. But I basically really like Kyushi Kurosawa because J-horror has sort of it has enough good content. I just don't see why anyone should give Angel Dust a pass. Considering Ishii's punk roots, that he would just sort of sail out and go be a journeyman director to a completely worthless, movie of the week genre property like Angel Dust. I find pretty disheartening. I appreciate that, Ishii, he wasn't ha like he didn't have it easy with his slightly more uncompromising route. He had to battle the studio a lot, and it was difficult for him making his like taking the road less traveled. But well, yeah, it is difficult, like no shit. But I'm not gonna give films like Angel Dust a pass. Just like why? I don't know. I thought it was completely worthless. The only thing like some sort of an upper class mush that's twirling super villain having this pithy psycho babble quips in pristinely decorated apartments, like that kind of a thriller. I mean, I just the only like I'm serious, the only thing I liked about the movie is when the zombies song Time of the Season started playing during the end credits. I like that and nothing else. I mean, just really, really, this film couldn't have been further away from what I was searching for. Just incredibly derivative, also run J-horror work. Some people liked it, but then again, those people probably like J-horror in general more than I do. I'm not against it, but yeah, I mean, I really can't say anything positive about that. And then the next film that I have seen from Mr. Ishii is Labyrinth of Dreams from 1997. Now, this was a fairly surreal work. It was basically surreal Considering that it's called Labyrinth of Dreams, I was surprised by how not strange it was considering Ishii's pedigree, as it were. Because, Labyrinth of Dreams, I was sort of reminded of Pedro Costa's film called Blood, the way that that managed to have a sort of a dream-like ambiance to it. This Labyrinth of Dreams was a film I saw even less coming than that Crazy Family. Labyrinth of Dreams, I just honestly didn't see Ishii having this in him, because I thought Labyrinth of Dreams was amazing, actually. Plot-wise, it's as if Ishii is doing, you know how Luchino Visconti was basically doing an unofficial remake of James M. Cain's Postman Rings Twice. I thought that the Ishii was basically doing an unofficial remake of Alfred Hitchcock's Suspicion. That's one of Hitchcock's sort of less seen Cary Grant movies. But anyway, I thought that this was plot-wise incredibly reminiscent of Hitchcock's Suspicion, but at first I thought that Labyrinth of Dreams was the best Hitchcock pastiche that I've ever seen. Brian De Palma has a couple of Hitchcock attempts. Claude Chabrol has several. François Truffaut has a couple. But honestly, initially I thought that Labyrinth of Dreams was the best Hitchcock pastiche that I've ever seen. But then I started thinking that, you know what? I think that this is actually better than Suspicion. Now, I definitely am not saying that Ishii's filmmaking is rising to the same level that Hitchcock is having. Some of those films in that filmography, they look incredibly schlocky and just thrown together. But Labyrinth of Dreams, I thought it was an incredibly assured movie. Just tonally, I thought basically a minor masterpiece. If the Crazy Family surprised me, Labyrinth of Dreams definitely surprised me even more. I saw a couple of dismissive reviews of Labyrinth of Dreams say that the plot isn't great, the acting isn't great, just a bunch of I don't know, just like you know, Alfred Hitchcock, he himself said that all through his career, Hitchcock had to deal with critics who whined about how plausible or how not plausible Hitchcock movies are. And Hitchcock just said that, you know, critics like that, they just seem like they're a pretty dull fellow. Who watches movies? When you're choosing to watch a movie, do you always make a point of choosing to watch the most plausible movie? This is called The Labyrinth of Dreams. It's sort of letting the bells ring about its sort of dream-like core. I didn't find any fault with this movie. I thought Labyrinth of Dreams was an amazing slam dunk of a great film. I really loved it. Yeah, I mean, I suppose I'd have to call it Ishii's best, although like this is a film that like it feels so weird saying like it just it didn't entirely feel like a Sogo Ishii movie, contrasted to some of those other projects. But well, I don't know. Anyway, I did see that film, and yeah, it was great. I mean, I highly recommend Labyrinth of Dreams. Like, if there are audiences who say like Leo Carax, Boy Meets Girl, or Polar X, or say that Pedro Costa film Blood, like if there are fans of that kind of 80s and 90s art house ambience, I think Labyrinth of Dreams is a film that I think out of all of those Ishii movies, Labyrinth of Dreams is the one that probably has the biggest chance of playing to general audiences. Apparently some people didn't like it, but I thought it was just great. And then the film that he did after that in 97, I mean, after that in 2000, was called Gojoe, Spirit War Chronicle. Gojoe, Spirit War Chronicle. Like, I'm not even gonna try to explain the plot of that movie. It was it sort of reminded me of Chui Hawk's Chinese Ghost Story, which I thought was a great movie. I mean, just I had a blast with that movie. Gojo Spirit War Chronicle, it's maybe not quite as good to me, but like if Ishii has just become like the kind of journeyman director who's just taking whatever, he goes to a studio and says that give me something that starts now and looks good. I mean, if that's basically become his attitude, I think with Gojo, he still managed to make I thought that the Angel Dust was disappointing because it was such a poorer version of what everyone else was doing around him in genre cinema. But I think Gojo, even though it's a similar journeyman work, journeyman work and feel, I feel like Ishii managed to elevate the movie with his presence. Like, Angel Dust clearly seemed like a movie that didn't need Ishii. Or at least it seemed to me that it didn't need him. Any music video director could have done that Angel Dust. But with Gojo, it feels like Ishii managed to sort of take this kind of silly, dragon slaying type fantasy movie. And then managed to infuse it with his own artistic sensibility to become something a bit more special. Like in Hollywood, I think Tarsem, I mean he used to be called Tarsem Sain, or how do you say his surname, but then he just shortened his name to Tarsem. But anyway, like in Hollywood, Tarsem is sort of doing those kinds of action film epics with like a slightly more accomplished and interesting visual style. So I think, Gojo, I'd say that it's a good movie, like fans of fantasy adventure, mainstream fantasy adventure films, they might think that Gosho is just great. I mean, you know, I'd say it was perfectly fine. Like, you know, one of the better films of its kind, I think, can be said. Then, you know, I already talked about Isn't Anyone Alive, well, from 2012. I mean, I don't even, like, that film just pissed me off. Crazy Family, Crazy Family maybe was like in intent a bit like a Sion Sono film, but Isn't Anyone Alive just looked like a Sion Sono film. I mean, I have nothing against Sion Sono, but like, again, given how interesting Ishii can be, like, I mean, he's meant to be some sort of a wild card filmmaker. Or, well, I mean, you know, I don't know what Ishii is destined to be, but like, his filmography is showing that he can be a wild card. But then it's just disappointing seeing him become something a bit derivative of those, like, I have nothing positive to say about Isn't Anyone Alive. It's just, it very quickly became obvious that the film would have nothing redeeming about it in my eyes. I would say that, well, I didn't like the end credits song in there, so I would say that it was my least favorite Ishii movie. And then there's two more that I have seen. I think these are like, whether these are classified as short films or not, I don't know. I think both are like 50 minutes long or something. So there's Dead End Run in 2003 and Electric Dragon 80,000 Volts from 2001. So I thought that these two films were like sort of, you know, complementing each other pretty nicely. Dead End Run is like an anthology movie of three short films. Three short films were all of the three short films in Dead End Run start with a character just running for his life. And that's a premise, and then it evolves to something random and then fizzles out, and then we jump to the next film. Like, I like the first one. The surreal musical of the first one, I thought was great, and then the last two short films just like seemed really bad. I mean, all in all, I thought Dead End Run was like just a really baffling project. Like, even though like Isn't Anyone Alive, I didn't like that, but at least I understand why it was made. Like, I can understand why someone might think that something like that was worth trying. I cannot understand why Dead End Run seemed I don't understand what about it seemed like a victory. There's a Japanese filmmaker, I think he goes by the stage name of Sabu. You know, Sabu, he has films like Postman Blues and Unlucky Monkey, I think those are two titles. I can't remember the others. But Sabu apparently is very infatuated with doing basically 90-minute chase sequences. Like, very extremely elaborate chase sequences. I don't know, maybe if like Ishii was on some sort of a binge of watching Sabu films, and he thought that he'd like do three quickies about something like that. I don't know, like Dead and Run was a pretty peculiar property. But anyway, the other 50-minute, I'd call them feature films rather than short films. Like, to me, Electric Dragon 80,000 Volt was a feature film. And it was actually the first, it was the first Ishii film that I saw. And it was the Ishii film that I assumed would go down as my favorite from him. You know, when I saw Panic in High School and I didn't like it, I honestly felt like maybe Ishii would go down as a one-hit wonder to me. And Electric Dragon 80,000 Volts, I mean, you know, I honestly thought that it was like an improved version of a Shinya Tsukamoto film. I didn't, like, I have nothing against Tsukamoto. I basically like him, but I thought that his Iron Man films were a bit poor, honestly. And I thought that Electric Dragon 80,000 Volts was basically like the version of the Iron Man films that I wanted to see. I thought it was like, you know, just visually dazzling and I don't know, just an electrifying experience. You'll have to pardon the pun, because that movie goes so deep into that direction that it just earns it. It earns it. But yeah, Electric Dragon 80,000 was, I thought it was great. And you know, it, like, to me, it felt like a more streamlined version of a feature film rather than a bloated short story. I mean, short film. But anyway, I thought it was great. So, out of my limited watchings of Ishii's films, the three that I definitely recommend are The Crazy Family, Labyrinth of Dreams, and Electric Dragon 80,000 Volts. You know, I could throw Gosho out there as like, you know, the kind of, you know, you might just well watch this. It's not bad. It's perfectly fine. But I want to save the two spots in my top five, which is uncompleted, because I want to save the spots for Crazy Thunder Road and Burst City. I don't know whether they're good enough to earn it, but I like living in hope that they would be. But anyway, if it should be so scandalous that one of those wouldn't be perfect or great or amazing, then I suppose Gosho will have to have the fifth slot in my top five. But I certainly have high hopes for Burst City, which, you know, if some people have been able to see it and are luckier than I am in this regard, then perhaps you haven't seen Fernando Arrabal's Car Cemetery, and I'm sure that fans of Ishii would certainly like it. But you know, that was the closest I came to Burst City, unfortunately. So, you know, like, this is that kind of cinema that's not quite art house and not quite simply genre films. So, like, this is the kind of more interesting stuff that I've been trying to watch, but because it's sort of difficult to get, I've basically walked out of cinema, that I feel like there isn't enough stuff anymore. But now I'm slowly coming back. And anyway, if you're a fan of these films and get something out of these videos of me trying to talk about them, you know, I thank you for watching, and I'll try to make a couple more when I can just find the right subject matter. But anyway, that was all for me. Thank you.